They are a very outspoken person. They are somebody who will get the job done. They believe in people. They build the community. But are they qualified to manage a portfolio, which comes to government? Are they qualified to manage national security, finance, education, health? Are they qualified to manage these things? That is not automatic. Because you're good with the community doesn't mean that you're qualified to manage those things. So you have three possible perspectives that people can take when casting their ballot. And so what I'm saying right now, all of this was said to say that it's fundamentally flawed from the very beginning. The whole idea of managing the freedom. You've exercised your freedom by setting up an institution to manage it, setting up a vehicle to manage it. But the vehicle is flawed, and we're not asking the right questions. We're talking about other things like boundaries and stuff like that, which are relevant and very, very important to the vehicle as it is. But even if it was operating at 100% efficiency, there was no perceived manipulation, there was no actual manipulation. I'm not talking even yet about people and their perspectives on how they can benefit in one way or the other. I'm speaking about strictly operating as you should. It's fundamentally flawed from the beginning because of different perspectives that persons can take to cast in that ballot. All right? So, that's one thing. And the last thing about the concept of majority as well, which is the basis upon which democracy is founded, is you have a 50-50 split, pretty much, between which direction persons vote. And I can make a couple assumptions, and of course there could be other assumptions made about it. But let's say that the 50-50 split, or let's say that there's a split because there's such a difference between the policies and the plans. If there is such a split, and there's 50% of the country that wants to go left, and there's another 50 that wants to go right, the difference between focusing on tourism and agriculture, or sports tourism, or whatever it is, God knows. If there's such a split, then there's also a problem. Because the people are disenfranchised. The idea of moving the country in a particular perspective, what this vehicle is supposed to do is to have you have a conversation and come to some singular agreement. Not everybody's going to agree, I understand you, but you're supposed to at least be able to say, if we're going to be moving together, you're going to have to at least be able to say, I prefer we go this direction, but I understand what you're saying. And in the short term, let's do this, and then let's switch here. We're supposed to all be on the same page, right? If the situation is that we have a 50-50 split and the policies and plans are actually the exact same, then it might be, well, I think that's what it is pretty much supposed to be. If everybody who is running to move the country forward. And so the split then defines people's preference on maybe how the mannerisms and how a person is approachable, how organized they are, how qualified they are. These are the things that will determine the split. But you have to also think about the rhetoric that transpires. Because on this, on the public platforms, they are promoting themselves as being, you know, they promote themselves as polar opposites. And if the plans and policies are the same, and they're promoting themselves as polar opposites, then it's divisive. The vehicle that's supposed to be uniting us, to move us forward, amicably, is creating separation. Alright? And when I say 50-50, I'm going to run through very quickly some figures here. And these are figures that I got from SKN Vibes. That's the only source that I found that had stats from the last election. And I'll just give you the constituency number and I'll give you the percentage of the percentage of people that the candidate would have gotten. And this is not considering spoiled or rejected ballots. So constituency 1, you have 50.06%. You have 2, 51.44%, 3, 55.61%, 4, 50.81%, 5, 58.48%, 6, 90.78%. 7, 65.51%. 8, 52.63%. 9, 54.24%. 10, 71.13%. 11, 51.88%. And of 11 candidates, only 3 had percentiles that were, had figures that were outside the percentile. 3 out of 11 had clear wins. Everybody else had a tip of the scale somewhere. And the first one, 50 point, which even rounded off doesn't amount to 51%, was a matter of literally 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 people determine whether the country goes left or right. Well, at least with reference to one particular candidate. I'm saying this to say, again, stepping back from what we know and what we accept, we are all people with the freedom to choose. I mean, the fact that there are 50, there's a 50% of persons who are, you know, basically disenfranchised from whatever direction they want to go is problematic. That's where you continuously have contention in this country. That's why everything is politicized in this country. It's, it kind of makes sense when you think about it like that. And last thing on the topic is the three top figures, the 90.78%, was Dr. Denzel Douglas, the former Prime Minister and current leader of the opposition. 71.13 is Honorable Van Zamri, the current Premier Minister. And 65.51% is the Honorable Dr. Timothy Harris, the current Prime Minister of St. Saint-Denis. Why do I mean this? Because if you listen to the names I just called, the positions I just called, they are the leaders. They are the top positions for each the opposition, the leader in St. and leader in Nevis. Which means if they didn't have the highest level of public approval, that would be problematic. That means that the public doesn't want them in that position. So their clear wins make sense. Everything else is tipping. And in the absence of discourse, in the absence of discussion, we will forever have issues. 7+ billion people on the earth, each with an opinion, each with a belief. We have a tendency not to have conversations, but they are imperative because you have a right to that belief, whether or not we consider it stupid, whether or not it does infringe on other people's rights, you have a right to that belief. Our position should be to have a conversation with you and try to bring you onto our side. And again, as I said earlier, it starts with us, but it ends with your neighbor. So freedom isn't just a matter of you opening your mind.
Yeah.
Freedom isn't just a matter of you opening your mind, but it goes beyond that. Your neighbor has to be on board. And sometimes I have conversations on Facebook, for instance, and when I'm finished, I just need to go and lie down. I do go and lie down and sleep for a couple hours. Because you go back and forth and back and forth. And a lot of people, sometimes it starts with 6 people having a conversation, it ends up with just 2, me and somebody. But I do it because I understand that you can't, as I intend to tell people, you can't outbreed them. If we look at the figures I just talked about, it, and the fact that we don't have conversations and discourse around political issues and other issues, social issues and whatnot, it means it just boils down to hoping that the people who support you have enough children for the next election. Because that's the only thing that tips it. If we're not discussing it, that's all it boils down to. You can correct me if I'm wrong. But if we're not discussing it, there's no reason for me to switch sides. Unless, of course, you observe the performance, and of course, those are things that you have to do as well. But the information isn't presented properly. It doesn't seem to be the basis for the movement. But in terms of what I said about you and your neighbor, take me for instance. I might be free thinking, standing up here in front of you this afternoon. But how free thinking are you if I decided to wear sharp pant? Well, you know. If I decided to wear a sharp and some joggers and, you know, just a vest this afternoon, if I came up here this afternoon, I'm going to hear how I came up here yesterday. Mr. Gil could talk about it, it was just out. Actually, when I came up here, I took whatever rubber band, but I was in Tom with a rubber band on it too, and it wasn't in a pop up. Can you actually sit down and listen to me, thinking that I have something worthwhile to say? Or would you look at me and just can't reconcile what is happening here? Yeah. It's what we do.
Yeah.
It's what we do. But I have the freedom to come up here like that. And I might be in a position where I can't do any better. Maybe I could do better about it here, but maybe I can't do better with the shoes, clothes, or whatnot. Alright? So, this freedom thing, me being able to exercise my freedom depends on you being able to open your mind as well. What about an 18-year-old young man? Loves finance. From a very early age, got in the habit of, well, first of all, he realized that money gets him the things he wants. Wants a little sweet, a little hot dog, gets it. Started saving, get your little allowance, you save. You get money for sports day, you get money for Christmas, you get money for birthdays, you save. And you realize, this thing gets me what I want, right? And so, goes to CFB, gets his papers, does well, goes on a job interview, kills it, nails it. Very impressive, charismatic, knowledgeable, friendly, humble, all these other things, willing to learn. But he has lacks. He's free thinking, he has lacks. The lacks don't mean free thinking, but he's free thinking and he has lacks. He hasn't subscribed to this image as being professional only. Professionalism for him is all about what he does and how he does it. But he doesn't get the job. He's disenfranchised because of what? Well, before I get there, let's talk about who this person is. Exactly. Somebody's perceptions denounced. Somebody somewhere, probably not even here, started it because this doesn't make any sense. Although I have believed it over the years that this is professional, it just doesn't make any sense, especially when all the place is hot. Not right now, but recent years the place has been hot, so I will stop looking like this, trust me, just now. I work for myself, I'm planning to stop. But who is this person? This person is Tyler Bailey, a former student of the Hamptons MBA program. It's a story from 2012 where the president of the program, he did a program at the college, forgive me, there's a ban on locks, dreadlocks. There is a ban for, I think it's 11 years, 2013 would have been 11 years, that there's a ban on dreadlocks. It's very real. So we think we're free, but you can't even wear dreads. This is a story of Ashley Davis, 2013, a Tower Loan employee who had locks. She was hired, and within either 2 months or in the company itself, they released some guidelines stating what you can and can't do. Locks, you can't have certain colors, you can't do certain things. A dress code, dress policy that they didn't have before, but they instituted. And she's the only person who is essentially breaking because of the locks. This is a story right here in St. Nevis, where I actually started doing a study some time ago because we were talking a lot about unemployment, and I was wondering whether the issue is really, of course I know that there's a shortage of jobs, but isn't just that. I wanted to know if there's more to it, and I wanted to know whether the problem is the employability of the population as well, the unemployed population. And so I started interviewing owners of companies, managers, HR managers of different companies, from hotels to banks, retail companies, computer companies, different types of companies, interviewing them and asking them about different things. One of which would be the interview process, because I'm trying to gauge at what point do persons not get the job, right? And part of the interview process, of course, you have to look at their time and their appearance. They hear it's part of that. And so I asked a question about if it does play a role, and yes, it does. It does play a role in whether or not you get a job. But the interesting thing about that, and about these stories, the other stories as well, especially for instance, Tower Loan, is that it's not just the person that was interviewed, it's not just the management, it's not just the owners. The problem that was articulated to me is also by and large, the population. How the population would feel with a dreadlocked young man serving them in a bank. So it's not just the owners, you know, we like to say things like, oh, the white owners. and how they oppress people. But it's not the owners, it's the general public's perception and dreadlocks. And young men with hair plugs. And the dreadlocks thing is not just a male thing. The dreadlocks thing is a dreadlocks thing. So if it's a male or even a female with dreadlocks, there's a problem. And a lot of times people don't even have a real reason. And I'm telling you this by my experience, because my hair tends to look like dreadlocks. I don't know if it looks like that, just in there. But it tends to look like dreadlocks. And so I've had the experience as well with people who I have gotten on forever, clinging to their perception of their not so well-founded perception of dreadlocks and everything else, instead of looking at the person who is in front of them. The fact that I haven't changed, and the changes that I have made are only for the better.
Sorry, but that's where the perception comes from, when the majority of people feel it, so that's where it comes from.
Majority, is that one again?
Look at marijuana. Mm-hmm. Look at marijuana. Mm-hmm. Look at what is happening in the States.
Right, the change.
Right? Mm-hmm. You know, when they start on legalizing it and they see what they're doing, what media is still holding on because of what they have.
Exactly. The discussion thus far has been about those things, has been about less obvious things. Because that is one of the things that would be in question. And if it's infringing on somebody's freedom to do it, then we have to at least question it. Now, you don't have to agree with it. You don't have to agree with it, but you have to at least give it some thought. Be willing and open and free to think. And we're not going to ever get anywhere. Mm-hmm. Alright? And so the public perception, I want you to really think about that, is that the public perception at the end of the day, it dictates what you are free and aren't free to do, as free a thinker as you are. And interestingly, there are women I know who have a problem with men going to hair, because long hair is for women, they say. But they're looking you in the face, telling you this, and they go, "I'm not here."
I've never heard that phrase before. What was it,
man? Oh, man, low cut.
They say thinking to a woman is shot.
Yeah, low cut. So, what you would expect to see on a man normally, because this is kind of out of the box. This is not what's accustomed. You know, long hair is not what's accustomed, especially if you're in a professional environment.
Right.
Things are changing, but it's what's the professional environment? And once you're at this age, you should be in some sort of professional environment. Then that's what is expected. But there, I can tell you that I know people who have that feeling. But again, we talk about principles versus rules. That's a rule. That's a personal rule. Your perspective that men should have short hair is your personal opinion. But it should end there. It should not be put on anybody else. And we have this thing, I think we also need to question what contradictions are. Because I don't really think it's a contradiction for a woman with a man hair to have an issue with a man without hair. I don't really think it's a contradiction. But you have to understand that where your opinion ends is with you. You can't force that on somebody else.
Yeah, let me use me as an example. Mm-hmm. This is the thing where we call pictures. Mm-hmm. To me, this is natural and indigenous. But the folks also have a problem with this.
Indeed.
They expect me to go and put chemical inside of this thing to look like someone who I am not.
Right.
You see?
And that's the question of beauty, but we need to also challenge the perception of beauty.
We have to wrap up soon, but let me add another perspective to this discussion. Use the example that Mr. Welch talked about the gentleman who is going to interview in the bank. Now, what we need to realize, within the wider, as this is part of the Emancipation Constant Festival, within the wider theme of emancipation, some of these rules that we have, where did they come from?
Exactly.
So to give an example, two young gentlemen go for an interview at a bank. One is a Caucasian. He goes well-dressed. He has long hair. He has his hair tied back neatly in a ponytail. So you have a Caucasian, blonde hair and blue eye, goes for an interview at a particular bank, well-dressed, ponytail. A black man goes for the same interview, similarly well-attired. He has his hair in dreadlocks, pulled back neatly in a ponytail, just like the ponytail Caucasian. And it is very likely that the person interviewing them or the panel interviewing them, if two of them are similarly well-dressed, similarly intelligent, similarly articulate, sad to say, but whether the interview is taking place in Toronto or Bastia or New York, sad to say, it is very likely that the intelligent young Caucasian gentleman with his hair up in his ponytail will more likely get the job over the intelligent young black man with the same name tobacco.
Yes,
yes, yes. Yeah. But you look at emancipation, we need to look at where these perceptions came from, a lot of them stem back to the colonial period.
Exactly. Yeah. Here's what I'll say, and we really need tobacco. Here's what I'll say. I'll make it even less obvious in terms of racism, and it's not even. My example is not even necessarily about racism, but it's again about questioning what's established based on principle, not so much the rules. The rules state certain things. The rules, like I said, for the tall old person is no locks. But if we question and we institute principles as opposed to just rules, rules are supposed to be built on principles. So I do believe in rules, but they're supposed to be built on something. And so let's use this same example, but shift it up a bit. And if the principle is on grooming, proper grooming, and there's also the understanding that black people and white people and other people from different races are different, and that the white person's hair is straight and it'll fall. Straight hair falling now won't be a rule. It will be about grooming. So if it's locks and it's well kept, if it's braids and it's well kept, then it would be acceptable. Right? It can't be about the things that separate us. The principle would transcend the separations. It can't be locks. Because yes, some of them, there might be other races or whatnot that are ethnicities that do locks, but even when it's not as obvious as that, it should boil down to principles in everything as opposed to rules. Alright? But pretty much coming to a close, I want to talk about something that I'm very passionate about. Which is what I call fast progress. And that's the reason that we find ourselves here now. That's the reason why when we look at the news, we see what's transpiring with black people in America. It's because of fast progress. And I'll give you a couple examples. There's a gentleman named Matt Cuban. He's a white, and I say white just because, I give races just because of the context of the conversation. But he's a white American businessman, investor, filmmaker, author, television personality, and philanthropist. One of the Dallas Mavericks. In an interview, he was talking about, well, the interview was centered around, or that portion at least of the interview was centered around race and prejudice and whatnot. And he talked a lot about it. He spoke about the fact that we are prejudiced and it's something that we need to work on. And indeed, yeah, prejudice actually is a natural adaptation. Because there is some truth to the things that we prejudice about, but it's coming to understand and evolve our opinions as we go along. Right? So he talked about prejudice and he said that we are all prejudiced and so forth. And he went on and part of the interview he said that if you saw a black person with a hoodie over their head and it's late at night and they're coming in his direction, he's going this way, they're coming this way, he's going to cross the street. He said, continue to say, if there is a white person with tattoos all over their skin and face and whatnot, he's going to cross the street. The point he was making, it's not necessarily about the race, it's just about our perceptions of tattoos, our perceptions of hoodies. This is it's his safety that he's perceiving, it's not about race, but there was outrage in America about it. Now, I personally don't see a problem with it, because I am sure that everybody walking through here does not feel comfortable walking just anywhere, even here in safe Saints and Needles. Not everywhere. And if you see certain people, you're going to be a little more alert than if you see other people. You need to, it's your responsibility to keep that in check. It's your responsibility to be as limited in your prejudice activities, so to speak, as possible. But it is an honest thing that we do. And what I'm saying is that there needs to be discourse about these subjects, there needs to be discussions. And if somebody is discussing it honestly, and we respond in outrage, how can we expect to get anywhere? We can't expect to move this forward if this is what we do. If every time somebody speaks, if a white person is not permitted to speak on black issues because they are white. Next example, Donald Stern, a Jewish American businessman, an attorney. He's the owner of the largest Los Angeles Clippers up to last year. He told his girlfriend that she should not be photographed or necessarily be seen in public with black people. The discussion centered around Magic Johnson, and what he said Well, there was a conversation, and she asked him whether if it was a white person, it would be okay. And his response, as published by CNN, would have been, "I know magic well. He should be admired. I'm just saying, it's too bad you can't admire him privately." The man on your, well, sorry, the man on your shoulder says, "Admire him, bring him here, feed him, have sex with him. Don't put magic on an Instagram for the world to see, so they have to call me, and don't bring him to my games." Now, I'll just say up front, the sex part might just have been, you know, in being, well, it might be serious, but, you know, sometimes we say things, right? So, but I want to focus on two very important things. The first is, he said he should be admired, which means he has an appreciation for the person. Might be racist, probably is, especially if you look at some of the stories that were presented. But he has some sort of respect, at least for his ability as a person, as a basketballer. What he also said is, so they have to call me. And while we argue about him, and he actually, I think, I'm not certain what the recourse was, whether he sold his team or he was forced out of his team or whatnot, but he doesn't have the team anymore. We are satisfied with this. This is progress. I'm talking about fast progress, but this is progress in our lives. But in reality, he says, so they have to call me. Who is calling this man and telling him it's problematic to be seen with black people? Nobody's thinking about this. We are satisfied because one out of 7+ billion people is out of a job and still has riches galore. But we don't try to figure out who these other people are, who don't identify themselves, who have these issues with blacks, have issues with other races, have issues with whatever the issues are. It will always be there because there's no conversation about it. There's no conversation about it. And if we talk about, let me see if I can run through this one. Let's talk about the latest American freedom, which is gay marriage. And I'll tell you my perspective first, which is, I was raised Christian, so based on that, I pretty much don't agree that that's how it's supposed to be. But I've always felt that's my opinion, and I'm supposed to keep it. If the guy that you serve hasn't done anything to wipe them out, person's from that orientation, then you should not be, and your behavior as well should speak to make persons respectful of your religion as well, okay? So, pretty much clear on, or did I just kind of stumble and trip over what I was just trying to say?
We get the point.
Okay, all right. But I like to compare homosexuality or the movement toward the rights of gay marriage with slavery. Why I like to bring this is because back in that day, there wasn't the internet, so it wasn't as easy for you to see how it went, how it snowballed. It started as a few people making noise. Then every media station started and had issues with it. It came to the point where if you disagree with it, as is your right, it's your right, you don't infringe on their right to do what they want to do, but it's your right to have an opinion. And it's like an ostracized word. It's outrage about it, you can't say anything about it. And so that's where I like to compare them. But the question is, questions afterward. The question is, how did you feel about it yesterday? If you disagreed before, how did you feel about it yesterday? And how do you feel about it today? It's now legal. Has your opinion of it changed? And again, I'll go back to slavery. We were thought to be less than other races. We were thought to be less than white. Your perception, Mark Cuban's perception, well, not so much his, more so than Saddam Hussein's perception, or anybody else who had the perception that we were less than human yesterday. The emancipation, abolition, all that does not change it in a day. It doesn't change it in all our years. And the Donald Sterling that I referenced here, if he has children, I'm not sure, I didn't dig that deep. But if he has children, what do you think he's teaching them? So if we have a question about why we're still in the same place, that's the answer. The perception remains. There's no discussion. And if every time somebody identifies themselves as a racist, we get upset, outraged, and we beat them into silence, all you're going to have is a lot of silent-based racists. Which is similar to the question I asked before. Look how we've come full circle. And let's see if you disagree with me now. If you're sitting in this room with racist people, wouldn't you like to know? How comfortable would you feel, how free would you feel sitting in this room knowing that the people next to you are racist towards you? But that's this kind of society that we created. The society we created is a society where we're beating you into silence as opposed to sitting down and trying to have a discussion with you. If we're talking about principles, you'll have to be, you'll have to come to some realization that you have no point if you say that a person is less important or less equal than. There comes that point where race is shown to be irrelevant, and so you have no point. And so that's what's necessary. Discourse is what's necessary if we're going to change anything from race, if we're going to have true equality and true freedom with reference to race, sexual orientation, here, gender, or otherwise, anything else, appearance and otherwise. And so I'll wrap it up. And I like to say that in terms of principles, religious beliefs can be built on top of the principles, laws and everything could be built on top of the principles, but as opposed to Anna Svensson, the New York photographer I spoke about, where court rulings then set the norm. We need people to go back to the principle that informed it. What is privacy? I couldn't have imagined drones, but now that they're here, what are you going to use as a basis to determine how they can and can't be used? What we need is principles. That's what we need to refer to. And in terms of an action plan moving forward to how we actually attain this dream, the first thing I'll say is to convert from a rule-based society to a principle one. Schools have been banning some interesting things recently. And well, the first point I actually have here is homosexuality, but I spoke to it just a moment ago. But I'll just reiterate it, saying that having a rules-based society where we go about creating norms and go about beating down people and setting trends and so forth based on laws is going to give us a problem. Because at one point in life, homosexuality was a very big problem. At this point, it's the norm. There are people who are going to come and meet you and not even know that it wasn't the norm. It's possible, maybe not, but it's possible that in the future, heterosexuality will be the thing that you're just trying and dying to be allowed to, at least based on the way that we've been speaking recently. Because like I said, the outrage that came about you speaking about homosexuality, you treated it as though you shouldn't even feel that way. Schools have been banning some interesting things. One of the things is holding hands. They call it a gateway sexual activity. A bill was passed in Tennessee early 2013 to ban it, and teachers are facing firing because of if they demonstrated. Hugging is another thing. They talk about respecting personal space, and they think it unsuitable interaction between students, which is in Portland, Florida, New Jersey, and New Zealand followed in 2012. Best friends. Teachers in the UK school, in some UK schools, have prevented children from making best friends in an attempt to save the feelings of others. And in Toronto, bars, all sorts of bars, because a parent suffered a concussion by being hit. So we're making rules, we're making laws, we're setting guidelines based on events. And there's a quote I can't quote word for word, but great minds think about ideas, not so much events, right? So living by principles, the next action point is that we have to live by principles ourselves. We have to be honest with ourselves. It's not about your opinion. I spoke about here before, and you might have that opinion, but, and it translates too. Because the here debate is one thing, and while we are struggling for the right to be as we naturally are, there are other discussions like things about Caribbeanness. Caribbeanness as relates to things like poetry, Caribbeanness as relates to things like poetry. But what I'll implore anybody to do that has that deep interest in making sure that we maintain our Caribbean identity is that we make sure that the same way that Americanization happened, we maintain our cultural identity. They permeated the media with it, so use the funds and the sources of income that you can get from different grants and so forth to try and create programs, create things that go on television that then have us seeing ourselves and appreciating ourselves more. Have more discussions about these things, have more lectures about them, and then we'll slowly but surely start to appreciate ourselves, as opposed to labeling one thing less worthwhile than the other, labeling American content less valuable than Caribbean or other ways. That won't get us anywhere, but also as we find ourselves in so many different things. Focusing on ensuring that people learn to think. I actually think you need to teach people most things. I think we need to first of all find a new way to teach people to think and go about even the process of education. But I'll give you a very real example. I think most of us in here drive. And I can remember even one day driving across the street and a lady steps into the street with her child. And when I say step, I mean she's walking. She ain't just stepping, she's walking. She's stepping across the street with her child. And she's with a guy who has a child in his hand too. They're all together. And he says, "Hey, wait!" That's where he's telling her. And she turns around while still walking. Women aren't good like that. She turns around while still walking, multitasking. And she's walking across that street. And she says, "There's a way for me." But this is what her child is saying.